Wonderful. Thank you very much, Justin. As Justin indicated, we really do have an amazing group of speakers with us here today. And this discussion, you know, I want to just make sure that we frame it, won't just be about what's happened here in Boston, but really how, as you guys think about going back to your own ecosystems, you can take some of the lessons that we've learned over the last few decades of what's been happening on here in Boston. I'm going to start by actually opening up the floor to Jeff, Carrie, Sarah, and Mark to actually talk about what they've been doing and how they've been involved over the last decade with what's been evolving here in Boston. Jeff?
Thank you, Dave. I've been an entrepreneur my whole career, primarily here in Boston. I've been a social entrepreneur since 2000, although back then I didn't know it by that name. I've been building an organization called CIC, which is home to many of Boston's best entrepreneurs. And since 2014, I've been bringing our brand of social innovation to other parts of the world through, we now have 3 locations elsewhere and many more in the pipeline. Starting in 2013, I started building an organization with CIC called Impact Hub Boston. This is the Boston node of a global network to support social innovators, and that's been my focus since then.
And can you just talk very quickly, kind of what is the thesis that you're working on with Impact Hub?
Well, the basic idea behind Impact Hub Boston is that entrepreneurs learn best from their peers. If you're doing something brand new, you can get some advice that's helpful from a mentor, but fundamentally, nobody can tell you what it is that you need to know to be successful. The people who can come closest are your peers. So we create a community of your peers that you can be part of, contribute to, and be successful with. And the outcomes all over the world are phenomenal. There are now close to 90 impact hubs around the world, and it's a growing movement. There are something like 13,000 social innovators that are being served through the Impact Hub network.
Wonderful. Carrie, we'll switch it over to you. You know, obviously tied into Babson now, but that's not where you started.
No, it's a really interesting question about how you define and begin to inform your interest in being a social entrepreneur and that moment when you decide, oh, I guess that's what I am, right, or I have been doing. I started my career as a consultant to the U.S. Department of Justice on crime. And at first, it just seemed very technical. And then over time, when Janet Reno was leading the Justice Department, she really focused in much more on the social underpinnings of crime. You know, was it poverty? Was it drug abuse? Was it child abuse and neglect? And so that got me very interested in trying to have an impact on those things that I was seeing in my own research that were causing social problems and social dysfunction. And so I decided to run for office with the clear idea that I was going to fail, but the acknowledgement that I was going to fail as a Republican in Massachusetts, but also with this notion that at least it would give me a platform to talk about the social issues and the research that I had been doing and others had been doing that I thought could help make a difference in making some progress in these social issues. And when I, surprisingly, eventually became Lieutenant Governor in 2002, I had this wonderful agenda of things that I knew needed to happen to make Massachusetts better from a quality of life social standpoint. And that brought me into contact with a lot of the wonderful social entrepreneurs and innovators in the state, and I began to see also how science really plays into that a lot of the technological and scientific innovations were also going to have wonderful social impacts. So when I left office, I did a little television show that no one ever saw called Shining City. I think it had 0.0001 viewers. It was like no viewers. It was on the sports channel. It was on NESN. But the idea was to let people know about some of the wonderful social entrepreneurs that are out there, some of the wonderful scientific and social innovations that were available to us if we funded them and if we embraced them. So now I'm really excited to be at Babson College. I don't think that I would be at Babson without that lead up that made me appreciate social innovation so much. Babson is dedicated to social innovation. They actually have a plank in their mission that has to do with advancing social and economic and environmental responsibility and sustainability. So I'm very excited about being part of that Babson movement now. And I now recognize that some of the things I've done have been actually a social innovation.
Wonderful. And you did have a very exciting announcement this morning. Could you just talk quickly
about
what you did?
We had a very exciting announcement today. Babson is opening a new facility downtown in Boston at 100 High Street. And one of the things we're going to do there is that we're going to be the first private college to host a global entrepreneur in residence program that will allow international entrepreneurs who've graduated from any graduate school to apply to be part of our program and receive an H-1B visa as part of that so that they can actually start their company here. And the reason why I said we would be the first private college or university to do it is because UMass Lowell in Boston did this last year, and even though they only had 10 international entrepreneurs in their program, they actually created 200 jobs and brought over $100 million in investment to the Commonwealth. So I would just want to help accelerate that and expand that program at Babson. Very excited about it.
Wonderful. Thanks. Sarah, very lucky to have you on the other side of the academic equation here. Give us a little bit of background about where you've been over the last few years and also some of the extracurriculars, because I think what you've done outside of MIT has been equally meaningful for our community.
Great, thank you. I'm delighted to be here today. My name is Sarah Gallup. I'm co-director of Government and Community Relations at MIT. I've been in that role for almost 26 years, if you can believe that. This is a thing of the past that people will be saying that out loud. I was a political science major. I always loved government. I worked for the city of Boston for about 8 years before coming to MIT. I truly am fascinated by municipal politics, if you can believe that. And in my role at MIT, I get to work very closely with the city of Cambridge. Cambridge is a progressive city. For those of you who are local, you know that. And there's always something going on. It's a very financially sound city. It has good policies. It's a great city to live in. And it's really interesting for the universities, Harvard and MIT and Lesley and Cambridge College, to be there sort of amidst all this progressive dialogue. So we always have a full agenda, and I really enjoy that work. We call it the town-gown relationship, if you've heard of that. And there's always surprises around every corner. I'm also a founding board member of the Kendall Square Association, right in Kendall Square. Kendall Square, if you don't know, is right next to MIT, on the other side of the river, in Cambridge. It really is Cambridge's business district. It's on a transportation node, and it has just grown like gangbusters over these past decades. There was a while when people called it a wasteland. And if you were around in the 80s, you'll remember that. You would drive there and nothing was there. One diner, the F&T diner, but that was about it. And the reason was because it had been an industrial area. Industry had moved on and it was in this transition mode for many years. Now we have pharma and VC and IT and many other sectors very vibrantly present in Kendall Square. So now I'm president of the Kendall Square Association, as I mentioned, and that's a real privilege for me. I'm joined today by our executive director, Alexandra Lee, who's here. And I'll be talking a little bit more about Kendall and Kendall Square, but I guess I'd also say that I'm a real student of human behavior. I got my MBA in organizational behavior. I'm fascinated by human beings and what makes them tick and how you can get them to work together. So,
wonderful. Thank you, Sarah. Now, one of the things that I think is fundamental, and we'll get into this a lot more as we open up this panel, but funding has always been a very fundamental piece of creating any ecosystem. And Margaret's been one of our real pioneers in terms of what's been going on. Mind giving us a quick background in terms of Greenlight Fund and what you guys have been up to?
Sure. Thanks, David. And great to be here with all of you. It's just wonderful to walk into a huge room full of innovators who are idealistic and passionate and committed to working to make big change in our communities and in our country and in our world. That is always energy that I drink from and become inspired by. So thank you for being here. I co-founded Greenlight Fund. We launched in 2004, co-founded it with John Simon, who's a venture capitalist here in Boston, who had been a social entrepreneur himself, as well as a for-profit entrepreneur, done very well at both. And the idea for the Greenlight Fund, or the problem that we saw that we wanted to address, was that we knew that there were social entrepreneurs who were creating amazing organizations with big scale ambitions that were really solving problems. We also knew that here in Boston, and in any city that we would find ourselves, we weren't making progress on issues related to poverty and issues that confronted residents of our city's high poverty areas the way that we needed to, be it in education, be it in healthcare, be it in violence reduction. And so we thought, if there could be some kind of connective tissue in communities that would allow communities to go out and find what's really working to put against the problems that they face, we could have a huge impact in our cities, first and foremost Boston. And so we created Greenlight to be that connective tissue, to build capacity first in Boston, ultimately in other cities, to attract the best of the best social entrepreneur-led social innovations around the country to our city to address needs that we desperately needed help with, where we weren't making the progress. And we also recognize that even though Boston at that point was and still is a hotbed of social innovation, we don't have a corner on innovation in the nonprofit sector any more than we have a corner on innovation in the for-profit sector. And so some people, you know, when we got started thought, you know, why Boston? Why, you know, why bring in innovation to Boston when we are such a hotbed of innovation? But I think what we all know is innovation happens where innovation happens. Innovation happens where entrepreneurs are. And that doesn't always happen in Boston. Part of our vision at that point was certainly Boston focused, but it was really, as I said, to help cities build this capacity and to provide this ability for social entrepreneurs to get to the places that they were needed most, driven by communities. So we envisioned, we've likened it to a distribution grid across the country where communities, cities could really help each other find and spread what works. And so we, about 5 years ago, began realizing that ultimate dream of having a very networked group of green light cities, and are now in San Francisco Bay Area, Philadelphia, Cincinnati, and we'll be announcing the launch of Greenlight Detroit on Friday with the mayor.
Congratulations.
So five toward what we hope is multiples of cities that can really build their muscles to bring in the best of what they're needed. And I'll go back to sort of what I said originally about people saying, well, why would you bring more social innovation into Boston where we have so many? And, you know, 10 years ago we said, well, when we reach this vision, we see Boston being a net exporter of social innovation. You know, right. At that point it was John and me and Melanie Damsker Camp and a few others who were, who were driving this vision, and they said, you know, yeah, okay. Well, in fact, it's happened. We've now helped Boston organizations get to Philadelphia and San Francisco Bay Area, and I do believe, based on these early days, that Boston will be a net exporter of social innovation.
Wonderful. This is a perfect segue to kind of the next question I had for the group. This is a very presumptuous topic that we're hitting on, that Boston is this global epicenter of social innovation. Certainly we made leaps and bounds, but I'd be interested, as people who've helped form the conversation, really the community, what is the one thing to you that really has made Boston fantastic in terms of trying to spur this energy? Jeff, why don't we start with you on this one? We'll go right back down the line.
Well, I'm going to talk about the broader culture of innovation that Boston supports, and social innovation is one piece of that, and I think it feeds off of that larger culture. So my question is, well, why do we have such a strong larger culture of innovation? There are hundreds, literally, of places around the world that excel in invention, coming up with great new ideas. There are very few places in the world that excel at innovation, taking that great new idea and figuring out how to get it out into the world so it can actually change people's lives. Boston is one of those few places. And at the heart of that, I would point to the kinds of great universities that we have that really focus not just on coming up with great ideas, but actually have built into their culture this idea of getting this out into the world, supporting entrepreneurship in particular amongst not just their students, but also their faculty, and see that as built into their mission. So I hope I'm not stealing your thunder, but to me, that's at the heart of what makes Boston different.
I would actually say, just from my experience, again, hearkening back to when I used to do research for the Justice Department on what were the new innovations around the country, there were certain places I would always go first. I'd have 50 states to choose from to go start looking for innovation, but I would always go to Massachusetts. I would always go to Wisconsin. I would go to Minnesota. I would go to Oregon. And why did I do that? I did that because there is a trickle-up effect from innovative and I would actually say progressive electorates who elect politicians who are open to collaborating with innovators and who are going to be rewarded for creating change. And I think that if there are populations who want to see change and who are concerned about social issues, there, it's more likely that you're going to see politicians who collaborate with social innovators and also with academia. And it is this wonderful connection between the innovators, whether they're scientists or whether they're social innovators, and the politicians, and then also it's a group. It is an ecosystem that has to be built, mm-hmm. but you can't do it without the politicians being open to innovation as well, because government support for innovation is so important. I mean, just today, the idea that Mayor Walsh made time to come by and emphasize how important it was that we have international entrepreneurs starting businesses here in Massachusetts and how glad he was that Babson was undertaking to support that, that got it on the news. And that will help the whole program succeed. Mm-hmm. And so there's this wonderful connection that has to occur between business and academia and government in order to be a truly strong, innovative social ecosystem, I think.
Now, Sarah, you obviously sitting between the entrepreneur, the academia, and the government, any one of those stand out to you or other parts of the ecosystem that you found even stronger?
I think that the thing that strikes me most in terms of creating a successful innovation ecosystem, and I'm going to draw on examples from Kendall again, and this sounds so, you know, like, don't we just do this every day? But the idea of building community and bringing people to the dialogue and giving people the opportunity to collaborate and be a part of something, right? It just sounds like a how to live your life kind of novel, but it's so true. And so I'm just going to tell the story of how the Kendall Square Association got started, because we, in 2008, Kendall Square was, the innovation was happening, and you know, we're like, wow, that's incredible. And we said to ourselves, geez, maybe we ought to be doing something about this. Should we harness it, or you know, maybe we should be trying to manage this somehow? So we put out an invitation to people who we knew around Kendall. This is MIT people and businesses and Cambridge Innovation Center, and 100 people showed up at a breakfast at Google, and we brainstormed, and we asked these simple questions. How do we improve Kendall Square? How do we protect Kendall Square? How do we promote Kendall Square? It seems so basic. And we had over 100 ideas of different kinds of things. You know, we need more wayfinding. We should be branding. We've got to fix the T. There was all kinds of infrastructure and, you know, telling our story kinds of ideas. And that was how the Kendall Square Association began, because we realized there were many of us who thought we wanted to work together. We wanted to tell the story of Kendall. So in 2009, it got started, and, you know, there has been a great deal of growth in Kendall Square. We have 25 new restaurants, and Kendall Square Association is over 150 member organizations now. And along the way, we worked with the Boston Consulting Group, and they did a study for us, pro bono, because for heaven's sakes, we had no money at the beginning, and hardly any now. But they did a study that declared in the end that Kendall Square was the most innovative square mile on the planet. And we all looked at each other and said, oh my God, you know, what are we gonna do now that we're this, you know? And so we started introducing more programs. We are trying to use our convening power to bring people together, to bring people to the table, to talk about tough issues and challenges. And the Kendall Square continues to grow. And then just a month ago, the Boston Globe did a special supplement on Kendall. It's a multi-paged supplement. And the headline was Center of the Universe. And we said to each other, oh my God, you know, we're the center of the universe. You know, it's just, it's at MIT, we often say that, you know, being a student or even working at MIT is like drinking from a fire hose. And it feels like this in Kendall. It just keeps coming. The innovation is just happening every day. And so the idea of community and giving everybody a voice, bringing people together, I think is a real element for its success.
Excellent. Margaret?
Well, since we're being Boston-centric in this part of the session, I do agree with Carrie, and I would expand it. There's sort of this confluence of this great history of progressivism and social movements from the Revolution to abolition and being the birthplace of public education and community health clinics, and more recently, health care and gay marriage, and all of these conditions that provide the ecosystem for innovation and entrepreneurship in the for-profit sector, great academic and research institutions, capital, talent because of that, that do make Boston special, I think, in the world of social innovation. And, you know, not can be replicated, is being replicated, certainly, but I think both of those things are special in Boston.
Wonderful. So, you know, I think at this point we've kind of hit on the fact that academia, government, the entrepreneurs, and Margie, we gave you a chance to brag there, but you had funders as well, kind of all have to come together to make an ecosystem work effectively. We've gotten pretty far down the path with a lot of these different pieces, but there's always room for improvement. Two kind of questions, and I'd love to kind of go through these relatively quickly. What is the biggest risk to Boston's social innovation ecosystem now? We've developed, you know, a pretty good foothold, but what are the risks? And similarly, but almost conversely, how do other cities throughout the world or other communities throughout the world win? How do they take down what we've started creating or create their own version of what we've done here? Why don't we start from Carrie, why don't you go ahead?
Yeah, if I could just go real quickly, I'd like to pick up on what you had said, Margaret, around this notion of becoming an exporter. Mm-hmm. And I am seeing that happening, whether it's Europe, you know, having branches around everywhere, or I know you had Tracy Palangian speaking earlier today, one of the pioneers here in the U.S. around social impact bonds, and social impact has been growing by leaps and bounds, but it did start right here. Science from Scientists, a very effective nonprofit that has been teaching young students to be more successful in science and STEM, is now inspiring branches elsewhere around the country. Literally, people just seeing Erica Engel speak and saying, I want to fund that in, I think, Minnesota, of course. So I think that we are starting to become a net exporter, and I think that the risk is that we don't figure out how to scale what's happening here. And if anything, other cities, if they can come and if we can figure out how to share that knowledge through organizations like yours or others, I think that's the best way that we can turn that risk into an opportunity of being able to actually become that exporter of social innovation.
So I can summarize, our path to winning is being the lead exporter.
Is the exporter, I think that's right.
By helping everyone else up, we rise our boats. Yeah. Sarah?
I see two challenges that we need to look at regionally. One is transportation. It's just gotten worse and worse. You hear it every single day from your office mates, from You know, you go to meetings and people, we used to always talk about the weather, now we talk about the traffic. And it's quite a serious issue. It will actually begin to have an impact on our economic development trajectory. And, you know, in some ways it's great news. It means that we are thriving as an economy. It's a bustling region. But it's a serious issue. When I think about Kendall's often literally in gridlock. It used to not be that way at all. And we're on a transportation node. And the red line, the system, the mass transit system in the Boston area is the oldest in the nation. So you would think it definitely is in need of some repair. And the state is taking a close look at that. It's trying to be strategic in the way it examines it, so it's thinking about issues like signals and switching, which can bring some efficiencies. I don't completely understand that, but they do, and they're willing to invest some money into that. But I feel like we can't just rely on the state. It's something we've got to all come together and focus on. It may require some private, public funding. And if we can't start to manage it, I fear that it will impact our the progress that we can make. We're all trying to solve problems, and I feel like it could impact our progress.
So we'll already lose to the rest of the world, who has much better transportation solutions than we do.
They do.
Yep. Other things that other cities could be doing?
One other challenge I am concerned about, and I know MIT is quite concerned about along with others, is if you look at the life cycle of innovation of the ecosystem, say in Kendall or anywhere in the region, we do well with startups, thanks to Jeff and lots of others who have been focusing on that. You know, the students who come out of the lab have a fantastic idea and need a place to start launching that. We do pretty well. We also do quite well with our larger companies. We have more mature companies in Kendall and in the Boston area. But the concern is, you know, it just doesn't, you don't go from startup to mature company. So what happens immediately afterwards for those post-startup companies? Is there space? And if there is space, can they afford it? And these are real issues now. The post-startup mode is looking at these questions and determining that they may need to go elsewhere, or worse, that they might fail because they don't have a place to bring their work out, to take it to the next level. So that's something that we're really concerned about at MIT, and it's another one of these regional solutions that we have to all look at together, I think.
Margaret?
I think we can't not address this issue of Boston leading in a not-so-great area, which is in income equality and income equity. And I love talking about this in a room of social innovators because I think Boston is in this place of where so much wealth and value is being created in the innovation economy and biotech and tech, et cetera, and that in some ways is driving the wealth gap. But I also think we can find solutions there. And so marrying what's so great in this city and in any city where innovation and startups and entrepreneurship really are where value is being created disproportionately, period, with the desire to ensure that people aren't left behind and that no economy is going to be able to be successful and sustain itself and grow over time without a solid, healthy middle class that engages in that economy. So I think the challenge for us as social innovators and for you as social innovators is to think about how through innovation, including through tech and through healthcare innovation, we are going to create a city where everybody can prosper and everybody can live. Transportation's a huge barrier. Housing is a huge barrier. We are, and I worry that we're going to lose more and more talent because it's too expensive to live in Boston. And that's for the people who graduate from college. Mm-hmm. So we need an economy that works for everybody. And so gauntlet thrown down. You know, let's do this. Let's figure this out. BUR did a great piece within the last week, just asking that question, like how does a city with so much innovation and a booming tech and biotech industry address the country's biggest wealth gap? We've got to answer that question.
Wonderful. Jeff, we skipped you on this cycle. I'd love to bring you back here, having done a lot more work kind of on an international platform. Where does Boston fall down? Where do other cities pick up?
Well, so many great comments here. I just want to pick out one or two things to amplify for a moment. We have a general problem geographically with real estate. We've stopped making more of Boston. We stopped in the 19th century. And we're running out of room because everybody wants to be in the epicenter of innovation, because that's where you're most productive. But we can't all fit, and we can't all get there because of our transit system. So I'm very jealous of my colleagues in Seattle, where Seattle just announced a 25-year program to invest $50 billion in mass transit. They're going to solve their problems around how do you get everybody into the city where the action is. And so that's a challenge not just for Massachusetts to take up and for the Boston region, it's a challenge for each of you to take back to your own cities, because we all face this problem of the revitalization of cities means that now we have to shift from a car economy to an economy that supports everybody getting into the epicenter of economic activity, and that has to be accessible for everybody. Globally, I think there's so much to be said, and I don't know what we have time for, but I will say that I'm thrilled that there are so many places in the world where innovation is happening and is being supported. The Impact Hub Network, as one lens to look at, you know, they get over 2,000 requests a year for people all over the world to open Impact Hubs, and they admit 24. But they're coming up in places like Yangon and Bamako and Tegucigalpa and Port-au-Prince. And that means that social innovators who actually live in those areas are going to get the community support that they need to be successful. And I'm really excited to see what happens as a result of that when the people who really understand the problems and live daily with the problems in those areas get to innovate and be successful with it.
Wonderful. So as much as I hate to do this, because I could ask these guys a million questions, I'd love to relinquish control over to the crowd to ask burning questions that might be sitting in your brains.
Thank you, back up Oprah mic. I'm Kristen, and I hail from the western part of our beautiful Commonwealth. And so I wanted, if anyone could comment on the role of gateway cities or thinking more regionally when there are cities that have been as successful as Boston has to extend that success out to the places where there's plenty of room. I mean, it's lovely out in Western Mass, and we would be very happy to have a high-speed train. So I work in Boston and live out there. So talk a little bit about how you can attract more people like me to continue to build your ecosystem and the one in the gateway cities.
I would say Boston, the Boston area has served well as a seedbed for economic activity that spreads to other parts of the state. Whether it's a business that comes out of MIT and then opens a plant in Fall River or in Holyoke, we certainly see that. There are lots of places around the state that have new jobs as a result of innovation coming into Boston, whether it's originating in Boston or landing in Boston from other parts of the world because they need to be here, and then they need facilities that are best served in other parts of the state. So we really do see Boston as having a regional economic growth effect. I realize it's not as much as everybody would like, including us here on the stage, but it is there and it is powerful.
I would just like to add that I think that social innovation often follows general economic development. And so as we see some of the second cities around Boston become hubs of innovation themselves, which I do see that happening in a wonderful way in Lowell and Worcester and some other places that have really are developing great personalities, I suspect that the social innovation and that community will develop around it. But I do think that it's not an accident that MIT is at the center of the area that you're talking about, right? So Kendall Square would not be Kendall Square without MIT at the core. So that kind of either intellectual or economic development, I think, is almost a precursor and a requirement before mm-hmm. you can develop the broader social ecosystem.
Wonderful.
Hi, I wanted to say first, thanks to GF, I was actually part of Impact Hub Caracas, and I can actually attest to the impact that Impact Hub can have in all parts of the world, specifically in low-income countries that really need spaces like this one, so thank you. And my question actually goes to Carrie. I got really excited when you talked about Babson creating the space for international student entrepreneurs, being a social entrepreneur myself. And I wanted to know, is it only open to Babson students? I recently checked out that they have 9 slots for Babson students. And also a follow-up question to that would be, do you also actually have to have a grad degree in business, or can it be an undergrad degree in business with a degree in marketing as a master's? Thank you.
Thank you. Now you're going to test the limits of my knowledge around immigration law. But I can tell you about our own program that it's certainly open not only for Babson students. We have 60% international students in our graduate programs, and so we were very excited about being able to offer this to them. But we were equally excited about being able to offer it to graduate students from throughout the region. And it's not even something that has to happen, as I understand it, immediately upon your graduation. In order to reach the requirements to receive one of these H-1B visas, and they're only given out in a 5-day period in April every year, and there are 233,000 people who apply for only 85 spaces. So we know that the competition is very stiff for them, so we think there's going to be a lot of people who would be interested in perhaps participating in this program, and we're open to that. We're starting with 10 slots, but you know, the estimate is that there are 1,000 international entrepreneurs who leave Massachusetts alone. So I'm hoping that other private colleges and public colleges will pick up this mantle and also duplicate the program so that they can also attract and serve some of these entrepreneurs. One of the requirements, though, is that what that entrepreneur is doing has to be core to your mission as an institution. And so for us, this is easy. Our mission is to promote entrepreneurship everywhere. So any entrepreneur doing anything is relevant to our mission. We're excited about having them. For other institutions, it may be a little bit more difficult to craft that alliance.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Riccio, the Director of the Social Impact Lab at Northeastern University. I represent one of those great institutional pathways that Carrie mentioned, academia, business, and government. But those are also pathways of privilege. And I think it's really important for us to be conscious of challenges of diversity and inclusion in our social entrepreneurship and innovation community, because it could be a really bitter irony if those of us who are addressing social issues don't have diversity within our own groups. And I think we've got a visual of it right up there on stage. Mm-hmm. And Margaret, what you mentioned about economic disparity is also a reflection of some of these social issues. So I would just love it if we could address that issue and what we can do in the innovation community to be more inclusive and aware that without diversity within the thought leaders in this space, we're never going to be able to address those issues at the social level.
Yeah. Does anyone want to feel that? Please, Sarah.
This is something that Cambridge thinks a lot about, as you might guess, and I feel like the combination of public policy initiatives and sort of, you know, an open source kind of dialogue can contribute to address these issues. And what I mean is that the city of Cambridge requires a certain percentage of affordable housing units have to be built in every single development. So in the Kendall Square area, we have a very high percentage of affordable housing units. The City of Cambridge also requires that the retail that we bring into our developments has to be locally owned, independent, retail that is at a price point that is accessible to all people. We actually negotiate this with the city. And the city requires that residents are engaged in all of our decisions. It's a very interesting model. So as MIT starts to think about how it's going to build out a new development that we recently received approval for in Kendall Square, you know, 1.4 million square feet of commercial, lab, office, retail, housing, that citizens are required to be involved with us to make decisions about what it's going to look like, what kind of activities are going to go there, you know, what's going to be community space. So I feel like it's a decent model. It doesn't get to all the issues you're speaking about, but it empowers people to be at the table and be part of the dialogue when we're creating community.
One of the things we think about a lot at Babson is how do we create a community of genuine inclusion. We have a lot of diversity in terms of numbers, but we always think about socioeconomic diversity as well. And unless you are in a position like MIT or Harvard to be able to supply a great deal of financial aid, then there's always going to be this tension around the diversity within an academic institution. So we're very dedicated to increasing the amount of financial aid that we're able to offer. Right now, we cover about 98-99% of demonstrated need for our students, but we want to do more, and we want to be able to do more for our international students for whom we are not usually able to offer financial aid. So we realize there's a real disparity there. We'd like to get more students of different levels of means from around the world to come and be able to participate in this ecosystem, because we think that would have a wonderful multiplier effect internationally. But I do find that when we have diverse students, especially at a school like Babson that's focused on entrepreneurship and especially social entrepreneurship, we have the director of our Lewis Institute for Social Innovation here with us today, that those students are particularly focused on solving the problems and concerns of their hometown and of people who are from their own communities. And so I think that one way to address this is to make sure that there's a lot of socioeconomic inclusion in our educational institutions.
I mean, thank you for the question and the comment. I think it's a burning important point. It's certainly the tech sector has been not diverse and has been called on it, and we'll see the extent to which the tech sector as a monolith will be able to deal with it. But I mean, in some ways, entrepreneurship is a privilege. People can be entrepreneurs because they have some financial wherewithal to step out and not get paid, to bootstrap from something. And so I think what we have to recognize as a social innovation sector is that we are privileged to be able to do this, to start up organizations, and we have to know that, and we have to understand that, particularly as we're also trying to make change in our communities for members of our communities who are not privileged in that way. And so that looks white, particularly. And we, you know, so acknowledging that is very important. I think we also, as social innovators, we can adopt many wonderful things from the startup world, from the entrepreneur world, from the tech and biotech world. That's not one of them, but we are doing it so far. So I think we're just called on, as leaders in this world and in this movement of organizations, to be sure that our organizations can reflect diversity of income and ethnic and racial diversity, that we are listening to the people that we think that we are helping, to really understand if we're in fact helping them, that the technology that we're using is used, that we don't fall in love with technology for technology's sake, but really only for solutions that are co-created with and truly helpful to all to people in our communities.
So there are lots of things that I could say in response to your wonderful question. I appreciate your bringing it to us. Let me just tell you a little story, which I heard from one of our members, David Delmar, who runs an organization called Resilient Coders. What they do is they go into the juvenile justice system and work with young offenders to teach them marketable legal skills that they can use when they exit the juvenile justice system. They teach them how to become web developers. They also bring kids in from places like Mattapan and Roxbury into our facility, which is located in downtown Boston on the edge of the financial district, and they teach them the same things. And what's been wonderful for David to observe and to share with me, and I'll share with you, is just watching what happens when you bring a group of young black males into a steel and glass office tower, and you say, you have every right to walk down these halls as everybody else here does. And so if you want to go down to the 16th floor and raid the kitchen there and come back with some snacks, nobody's going to look at you as if you don't belong there. And guess what? That's a new feeling for these people. That's not something they've ever had the experience of before. Now, I don't know what kinds of things come out of having that very different experience, but I hope that one of the things those young men get is the idea that they can achieve, they could be in a place where this is what they do every day. They go to work in a place like this. And that's my hope, and I wish Dell every success in making that happen.
Wonderful. So I hate to do this even more than I hate to relinquish control, but we need to wrap up on this so that if anyone wants to come in and meet any of our speakers. One more question? All right. I lied completely. We got one more question then.
Okay. Last question. Hi. My name is Ross Chesnick. I'm an MBA student at Babson, so I think we have some decent representation on the panel, including David Brown. So one of my questions is, one of the things that the social entrepreneurship community has struggled with is to mobilize talent to actually get involved in some way. And there's organizations out there like New Sector Alliance that tries to incentivize talent to go out and actually work for NGOs or other social enterprises. I'm just curious, in getting feedback from the panel, what trends or organizations are starting to pop up to address this talent gap issue? And is it really centered on the fact that social entrepreneurship, to some people who aren't familiar with it, don't associate big impact with big dollars, and is that a deterrent itself?
That's the last part.
So the last part of the question Ross was asking is, Ross, maybe one more time.
So the two questions, which is one, what are some trends that are occurring that are allowing talent to be mobilized towards social entrepreneurship or NGOs mm-hmm. associated with social enterprise? And do you think one of the deterrents is that social entrepreneurship isn't associated with big dollars?
Okay. So the funding, the job salary prospect.
Yeah. So I think there are a lot of interesting things going on, maybe not as many as we want, to expose people to social entrepreneurship and the nonprofit sector. You know, and you need all of the nonprofit sector. New Sector Alliance, you mentioned, I think many of the universities and Babson may very well have opportunities for fellowships and group projects and internships. You know, I know at Greenlight we've benefited from fellows from social fellows from Harvard and Duke and other universities, you know, are doing that. And by the second question, if you mean, do you think that it's that part of the talent challenge is that we don't connect social entrepreneurship with big dollars, it's just that the nonprofit sector doesn't pay like the for-profit sector? Is that kind of what you're
yeah, I think that's where he was going, but
yeah, partially. It's also the stigma that social entrepreneurship doesn't equate to big dollars or big investment from salary or your return investment.
If you don't mind me jumping in here, one of the things that we talk a lot about at Babson is the triple bottom line, or this notion of pursuing simultaneously making money but being concerned about the environment and the impact that you're having on society and your employees and so forth. And we hope that the people who graduate from Babson don't feel like you have to choose at all. And maybe that this is a message that needs to get out more broadly. We're doing a lot of good work, and the Lewis Institute has done a lot of good work around this notion that companies that simultaneously pursue the triple bottom line actually are more profitable, their employees are more satisfied, more likely to stay, that there are traditional rewards for actually valuing other things than making a profit, so that you will still make a profit, and in fact you'll make more profit if in fact you're also thinking about your employees and society and the environment, and making sure that people know that your company had that value, that your employees become more invested and more excited about the other parts of your mission if they know that that's a part of it. So I'm hoping two things. First of all, that in the future we don't have to have separate notions about social entrepreneurship and entrepreneurship. I tend to put them all together and think that we should be doing that simultaneously. And I hope that in the future there will be some enormously wealthy social entrepreneurs who we can focus on and point to and say this person has, you know, succeeded and also done so in a way that's entirely socially responsible, shared their wealth and shared the wonderful experience of being an entrepreneur with all of their employees and benefited their community. I can think of several of those people right now in my mind when I'm thinking about the new kinds of businesses that are being created by Babson graduates and others. So I hope that's the future.
Anyone else?
I'll just give one example that's going on in Cambridge that I think is pretty exciting, and that is that there's a charter school in East Cambridge that serves a diverse population, but including low-income families and students. And it's taken a few years, but every single member of the senior class every year has a year-long internship with local Kendall and Cambridge businesses. And, you know, it's not come in and shadow somebody. It's a whole year of work, and then the relationships that come, and there's this expectation that there'll be a partnership between the business community and this school. And there are other examples like that, but I think those kinds of collaborations can really make a difference in the long run.
Thank you. Wonderful. So, on that note, I actually will wrap it up. If you guys want, I think these guys will be hanging off on the side of the stage for a few minutes. But please join me in thanking Margaret, thanking Sarah, thanking Carrie, and thanking Jeff for joining us for the panel.